out there in the real world, there's a whole lot of stuff going on all the time. Individuals engaged in a whole array of economic activities, earning a living, managing an income, trying to look for investment opportunities, etc., etc., etc. Finding some shape and some pattern in what's going on out there is the analytical task we face as political economists, or more generally as social scientists, trying to understand the world so that we may reshape it for the better, or at least make some modest contribution to that process. But then there's a third sphere beyond the reality out there and the analysis developed by intellectuals, and that's the sphere of understanding. And all of us, I think, grapple with that. There's vast amounts of information, vast amounts of arguments about what is and what could and should be. What goes into our heads and what do we act on? And in particular, what do policymakers act on from among that buzzing array of information that they deem useful and appropriate for their purposes? That third realm is a realm of what you might call social psychology. It's to do, for example, with personal experience that makes some ideas resonate more strongly than others. And I think back to, for example, to my own personal experience growing up in the UK in an area that was then quite a rural area. It's since been swamped by urban expansion, suburbanisation of a nearby big town. But when I was growing up, I, as a kid, used to love wandering around the fields. I came to know that most of those fields were owned by a landowner. A hangover, so to speak, from a medieval England with a big country house, a massive estate, and but that none of that worried me because I would freely roam the area, climb over fences where necessary, scrump the apples out of the orchard because surely there were many more apples than any single household could possibly consume, and so I didn't feel that it was outright theft to get a little for free. Some years later, I went back as an adult to revisit some of my childhood haunts, and I went wandering around the estate just like I used to, and some guy came up to me. He might have been a gamekeeper or something like that, and he had a gun. And I mean, guns aren't very common in the UK, although people do use them for hunting, and I was a bit apprehensive, and because he yelled out across the field to me, "Where have you come from and where are you going?" And I yelled, I'm just going for a walk, just going for a walk. And he said, "Well, go back to where you came from." And I did. But it was a moment for me when I really thought the question of private ownership of land and the exclusive use of land really resonated. And I remember it to this day as almost like a life-changing experience. Life-changing experiences which cause you to think some things are important and other things aren't. And I say this with some hesitation because I've made my career as a university academic on the presumption that knowledge is something we acquire to be useful, to be applied wherever it can make a contribution to human advancement. But I observe, not just particularly among students, but more generally among the general public, that some knowledge is acceptable and others isn't. Indeed, think about knowledge of climate change. People are sometimes skeptical, that's fine, but deeply resistant to accepting the evidence, the arguments, the analysis. And so you think, well, what is this barrier that is so obstructing progress in an area such as this? I might come back to the issue of the political process itself and our political institutions, because in addition to the challenges of economic insecurity, which involve often increased layering up of debt, increased insecurity of work, a growing incompatibility between housing unaffordability on the one hand and volatile and uncertain wage incomes on the other hand. I'll pause at that moment because when I'm talking to student audiences, they immediately relate to that. How could you buy a house if you don't have a steady job with career prospects? I mean, just making the commitment itself, even if you pass the criteria for getting loans, involves taking on an enormous risk, which frankly you wouldn't want to burden the next generation with if you've got any sense of social justice at all. Mark you, the notion that somehow all of the oldies have stuffed all the opportunities for all of the younger folk is a bit misleading, because among the oldies are some people who are doing very nicely indeed and are sitting on valuable real estate, quite able and willing to help their offspring acquire property, sometimes buying it for them, certainly lending them money that'll get them started. So what I'm saying is not a problem of intergenerational stress so much as the intragenerational stress, which become magnified over the generations themselves. Can our political system resolve these sorts of issues? I mean, in Australia, one has to be, I think, rightly sceptical about whether governments can tolerate the possibility of falling real estate values, for example, given that the appeal is always by the major political parties to people who see themselves as having a stake in ongoing appreciation of land and property values. They'll talk about the problem of housing affordability facing first home buyers, but the only way actually to make housing more affordable is to reduce its price. Of course, it would help if wages were rising too, but even that wouldn't solve the problem, because already we're in a situation where the average urban house is going to take 10 years or more of wages to become affordable. It's not surprising that people have become very sceptical about the political system's capacity to solve economic and social problems. I think George had in mind the notion that if you just develop the evidence and the argument, then people of good intent and good thought will act on it, including by introducing appropriate policies. His mechanism and weapon for social change was the force of his argument, and perhaps also to some extent the strength of his character, those warm, witty and wise characteristics for which he became so renowned. If you were here with us today, I think he would, like all of the rest of us, have to grapple with the profound problem of the modern state. What is it? It's not just a carrier of vested interest. It's become, in a sense, an obstacle to progress itself. And not surprisingly, some people have turned to erratic public figures such as President Trump in the hope that somehow he can drain the swamp, change the array of political possibilities, whether for better or worse, we don't know. But let's do something different. Seems to be a sentiment of that kind abroad. And of course, we know the potential for corruption of the political system. I brought along a bag with me today. It's not actually an Aldi bag, but if anyone's got any bunches of used notes that they want me to deliver to Sussex Street in Sydney, I'll be passing that way tomorrow afternoon after I go back to Sydney. So I'll leave this over by the piano.